Ever. That means today he's on the throne. He's head of the church and he's called the chief shepherd. When he's head of the nation states, he's called the king of kings. And Jesus said, all authority has been given to me on heaven and on earth. That includes all civil authority. And then he said, therefore, because of that, go and make disciples of all nations. He didn't say, go make disciples of disciples. He didn't say, go make disciples of churches. He said, go make disciples of the nations. That's why on Monday, we're talking about how to disciple a nation, giving them God's civil law. Remember, God ordained three institutions, the family, the state, and the church. And the majority of scripture is actually on the state from Exodus until Acts chapter 2. It's all under God's leading a state and showing when you honor him and put his law first and his honor and name first, he blesses it. When you don't, you get cursed. It's as simple as that. And so we're looking at how nations and our nation and your nation can be blessed or why it's being cursed. And it's all up to God's law being obeyed and Christians mandating, as it says, go and make disciples. The word make there is in the imperative. He just assumes you can do it because he says, I'm with you even to the end of the age. Just like when Moses told him to go to free the nation, the Hebrew children from Egypt, the most powerful nation in the world. And he said, well, but I'm with you. That's all that matters. If he's with us, whatever he says can happen. But we do it. Pharaoh isn't going to just let the people go. No, the people of God, Moses and Aaron, his spiritual leaders had to go and demand it in the name of the Lord. And God worked for him as we do that, like John the Baptist did with towards King Herod, saying, you're breaking God's law. He might have said, I'm under Roman's law. I'm under Caesar's law. But you got to realize he is king of kings. He's over Caesar. And he gives Caesar life and breath and all things. And you're under God and you're breaking God's law. Anyhow, we're going to. So that's on Monday. We do that. Vince, toss up, if you would, Kevin Bianco, the schedule. I want you to see every week we're going through. Each day is a different topic. On Monday, it's on Christian nation. And how to be Christian nation. Tuesday, it's the New Testament church, which you'll see. We'll go into that. What it is, what it was like in the New Testament. It is so foreign. The traditional church today is so foreign. It's so far from the New Testament church. We call it church. It may be a good church in some ways that it's getting the gospel out or teaching the Bible, but the function of the New Testament church is nothing like the functions in a traditional church today. Not not even close, as you'll see. And that is distinctive for making disciples, because the church was designed to build disciples. And it's contributing, but it's not doing it like it did in the first century, until you understand the distinctives that are very clear that God gave instruction for. And then Wednesday's marriage and family. There was a young gal in her 20s that said she's just really glued to this on marriage. I guess she's planning on hoping to get married soon. She's, I think, in her mid-20s or so. And this, if you're a gal or a guy, we're talking both to husbands or wives. Or if you're not married, you'll know what really a good spouse would be, and how to really find and know you're marrying somebody that's going to be good. So anyhow, that's on Wednesday. Thursday, it's Jim's life. That's me, my testimony. Paul gave his testimony more than any other message. So I'm giving my testimony, and I'm telling you experiences that have happened in my life and my progress in life, the good, the bad, and the ugly. And somebody just came online just a minute ago and said they're really enjoying that. So I'm enjoying it, but some of it's kind of suffering. I'm having to share, be honest. And so I'm sharing everything as I'm going through my life. And some of you will really relate to it and hopefully help you. And then the last Friday, it's basically your program. You can ask any question about me, anything, or about yourself, or about your family, or about other people, or about other things, or politics, or church, or house church, you name it. It's basically your program. Anyhow, today we're going into Christians Nations. On Sunday, pro-life evangelicals, so-called, for Biden wrote an open letter to President Biden, calling on him to, quote, honor his commitment, end quote, telling him they, and I quote, feel used and betrayed. Oh, surprise, surprise. Pointing out the exclusion of the Hyden Amendment in the Democrats' $1.9 trillion so-called CCP virus relief package. In that package, they struck out the to not have the Hyde Amendment in the Democratic $1.9 trillion package. The Hyde Amendment is legislation that took in effect back in 1980 to prohibit federal funds from being used to perform abortions. These evangelicals said that they felt used and betrayed because to obtain their support, they were told there would be dialogue with them, but stated that it hadn't occurred so far. Oh, hello. I don't know who those evangelicals are, but it's amazing how naive some evangelicals are. Quote, the Biden team wanted to talk to us during, this is what this evangelicals, believe you me, it's not all evangelicals, but some so-called evangelicals. They said the Biden team wanted to talk to us during the campaign to gain our support. Of course, the letter continues to say, and we gave it on the condition that there would be active dialogue and common ground solutions on the issues of abortion, end quote. Well, then they went on to write and said there has been no dialogue since the campaign, they added. Oh, lo and behold, I just love all my brothers. If they're truly evangelical, if they're truly born again, I love you, brother. But the naivety is just shocking to me. Last month, the president of the Catholic Civil Rights Organization released a scathing rebuke of the Equity Act introduced by Democrats. The Equality Act. Equality sounds good, but of course it's what the bill says. They always give a lot of neat titles to make it seem good to adopt it. But when the Democrats signed it, it's usually, and in fact, it's always been immoral in one way or another, taking out the Hyde Amendment in the Corona bill, which only I understand only has a tiny percentage of it really for the virus. But having said that, the president of the Catholic Civil Rights Organization released a scathing rebuke to the Equity Act introduced by the Democrats, saying it promotes, and I quote, the most comprehensive assault on Christianity ever written into law. Wow. Bill Donahue, president of the Catholic League for Religious and Civil Rights, said in a press release that the, quote, patently anti-Christian, end quote, legislation would allow, then he said, and I quote, gay rights to trump religious rights. In other words, to put their rights above freedom of religion, which is built into the Constitution, the Bill of Rights. He went on to say, healthcare providers would be forced to provide hormone therapies and surgical procedures that are required to change the physical characteristics associated with sex changes. Kansas City Archbishop Joseph Newman said in a recent interview that Biden should acknowledge that his support for abortion contradicts his professed Catholic faith. Yeah. Quote, the president should stop defining himself as a devout Catholic and acknowledge that his view on abortion is contrary to the Catholic moral teaching, Newman said. Well, I just brought this out because, you know, here's a bunch of evangelicals that voted for Biden, probably because they didn't like some of President Trump's tweets. Look, all of his tweets put together, the worst ones you could find, they don't compare to one of the policies that have been demonic in what Biden has done. Pro-abortion immediately, putting money into other parts of the world to help advance abortions, taking out the Hyde Amendment from the $1.9 trillion bill that they just put forward, forcing certain transsexual, saying they don't want to be discriminatory, but they are being discriminatory, and the discrimination is coming against Christians. It's all discriminatory against God's moral law and against God and against God's people. That's where the discrimination, they don't mind discrimination, can't discriminate against anybody else. You can't discriminate against Satan, of course, or demonic things or immoral things. But yes, you can and will, and you must discriminate against what Christians can do and in following the convictions of the Bible. Anyhow, that's Biden's latest as of Sunday. These evangelicals, I sure hope they learn to realize, good for you, voting, but if you vote for the wrong person, shame on you. And if you can't know the difference, it's not difficult to tell. Maybe listen to our show more. Maybe you should have listened to it earlier. Anyhow, we got Vince in California. He's telling about what demagogue Newsom is all about. Vince, are you there? He's going to bring in hey there, Vince, how you doing, buddy? I can't hear you, Vince.
It's great to be on the show this afternoon, Jim, here in California.
Okay, tell us what's happening with Newsom, your latest.
Well, there's an assortment of things going on. I think Vince Capahead is going to put a small clip on. Right now, we're at 1.95 million signatures at this point. So we've passed the threshold, and there is a gleam of hope to see Gavin recalled from governorship of California. A quick quote, I think you would appreciate it, Jim, from a gentleman who spearheaded it. We want to let everyone know in California, especially to all those corrupt politicians like Gab across our neighborhoods, the lobbyists, the communities that have destroyed California's dream for decades and generations, is that your game is over. And I love this part. From now on, the people of California will be in charge of California. And I say amen to that. We the people need to take charge of our families, communities, and cities and quit letting the bad apples run our state into a muck. And that is what Governor Gab has done. He has done a good job of that, has destroyed many countless businesses here on the West Coast and people's lives, Jim.
It's incredible.
Tonight, the pressure is mounting on Governor Gavin Newsom over his handling of the pandemic. Public opinion now more split.
I think he's done a great job in keeping people safe.
Seems like Gavin's out of touch with the common people here in the state, and he thinks he's above the law.
A new poll by the Berkeley Institute of Governmental Studies shows 46% of Californians approve of Newsom's job performance, 48% disapprove. That's a drop from September when 64% approved. Music to the ears of those trying to recall Newsom.
This has become not just a political campaign, it's become a movement.
The official Recall Gavin 2020 campaign says it has about 85% of the 1.5 million signatures it needs to put his job on the ballot.
The fact that he has completely mismanaged this entire situation. There's many states that have handled the crisis in a much different manner. They didn't have to shut down the fifth largest economy in the world. They didn't have to destroy people's lives.
Tonight, Newsom's team responding in a statement, quote, voters recognize that this is an incredibly challenging, intensely complicated, and critically important moment for public officials worldwide. That's why the governor remains laser focused on vaccinations, reopening, relief, and recovery. Pointing out in that same poll, only 36% of voters supported the recall, which is about how many supported Trump in 2020 and Newsom's last challenger.
The bottom line here is he's not looking nearly as good as he was just 4 months ago.
The recall campaign must submit its signatures by March 17th and expects a statewide ballot in the summer. Ian Cole, NBC Bay Area News.
Threshold now, and they've got hundreds of thousands way above what the minimum was to vote to recall him.
Yes, and of course, Governor Gav got in a lot of hot water this past year when he told all of us to keep your social distancing, wear your mask, and then there he himself contradicted himself at the French Laundry TikTok video, had him there with the entourage. And they weren't minding their own rules that they put on the people here in our great state. So I say all this, Jim, is because there is hope. As goes the West Coast, even the East Coast, if we can get a gentleman like this who is so corrupted and is a left liberal extremist out of office, I think there's hope for our country, especially when the people get involved.
Yeah. There are
so many good people out there. I was in Texas this last weekend. Just so many great people. We just got to get involved and rise up and rid ourselves of these corrupt politicians.
Well, the problem is he's touched the apple of the Lord's eye, as we're referred to in scripture, because he's dictating what churches should do. He's tried to put himself in the place of the great chief shepherd, the Lord Jesus Christ, in telling churches if they can meet, how they can meet. Or when they meet, they can't worship and sing to the Lord. I want to tell you, he's going to need more than good luck when he starts defying and going after the people of God, which he has done. And I'm going to be sharing more on John MacArthur and some things that are happening in the church there, which is kind of interesting. And you also had a report on the associate or assistant secretary for health for Biden. Tell us what's going on there.
Well, Mr. Rachel Levine, obviously, he is a transgender. He's confused about his sexuality and who he is. Well, now Biden has appointed this individual as the first federal official openly transgender. This is a quote by Biden I can't believe this quote by the guy, but this is what he says: "Will bring steady leadership that we so desperately need," says Biden. "She is historic and qualified to lead our administration and help efforts." And these are my thoughts, is there's nothing healthy about an individual like this who is confused about who he is, who she is, and how, what is so healthy about an individual like this, Jim? It's just an individual has been caught on camera dressing like a little girl. And now, Mr. Biden, I don't know. The old rule of thumb, Jim, is show me your friends, show me your entourage, your close friends, and I'll tell you plenty about yourself. And Biden has done he's made an interesting move with this particular Rachel Levine.
Yeah. Well, it's one thing, you know, there's some people certainly that are totally are ignorant to God and his ways. And we pray and we want to lead them to Christ so they can be delivered from the bondage of sin and perversion and destruction, moral, physical, emotional, spiritual destruction. But it's quite another thing when you have a civil leader that actually promotes perversity. That comes into the category of real wickedness. And when John the Baptist was reproving and got martyred for reproving King Herod for marrying his brother's sister, what Biden is doing doesn't even, what King Herod did doesn't even compare to what Biden is doing. I mean, King Herod would have been like a choir boy in comparison to Biden. It's unbelievable. Biden has been pushing some things that Adolf Hitler himself didn't push in the demagoguery of Nazism. This is mind-boggling. And for Christians to be silent about this, is really sin in and of itself. By the way, one question came in on Newsom. Is there any talk about who might replace Newsom?
There's an ex-mayor out of San Diego. I believe his last, I want to say it's Cox. He's the ex-mayor of San Diego. He's a Republican. He's in the running.
I'm a little familiar with him. I think he's a pretty good guy. Maybe, Vince, you could find out more about him so we could know. Some said, well, who's the alternative? If you could find out more about him so we could maybe take a closer look at him next week, that would be great.
Yeah, Jim, really quick, going back to Gavin, you mentioned something there toward the end about Gavin is now dictating to the Church of God here on the West Coast about what we can and cannot do. You know what's more saddening about that is that there are church leadership that are falling for it. They're actually listening to him rather than God's word. Shame on you. Shame on you that you're letting an agent of Satan dictate to you how you ought to worship our Lord and basically being spineless. I'm sorry. Yeah,
they confuse render to Caesar what belongs to Caesar, but that doesn't belong to Caesar.
Absolutely not.
God's church does not belong to Caesar. And that's why Jesus was quick to say, and unto God what belongs to God. And really, when he said that, immediately they understood. Someday we'll look into that verse more clearly. But it meant everything. Then even Caesar belongs to God. Everything belongs to him. So nothing can be out from under his authority and his direction. Civil leaders have no authority beyond what God gives them. They may have power. I mean, rebels have power. Traitors have power. Wicked people have power. Satan has power. But Satan and his agents are not God's civil authorities. God may use, he uses Satan at times, but that doesn't mean that's his delight or that's his ideal or his desire. He only uses Satan usually to punish the people, even the people of God, when they turn away from the Lord. They're choosing unrighteousness, and so he lets the leader of unrighteousness come in and experience what it's like to live under him or under his leaders. So anyhow, brother, thanks a lot for that. We got to keep going, and we'll talk to you later. Anyhow, love you too, man. I wanted to talk a little bit, since we're on California. In fact, Vince, put Vince back on here if you can. Vince, I'm going to be talking just a little bit, and you hang in there and you can listen. If you've got some comments, because you're there, you might have some thoughts. But I want to share a little bit about John MacArthur and Grace Community Church, what they're going through. I thank the Lord for John MacArthur, but I don't line up with everything that he might think. But don't feel bad, I don't line up with everything that I think. So, anybody that says the Lord Jesus Christ is the Savior and Lord, I'm for him. I don't think we as believers should take strain at the gnat and swallow the camel. We need to be as united with believers as we can, as long as they're moral and righteous and are preaching the gospel. They may have different views in a lot of things than we do. But John MacArthur's that way. I thank God for him. And the state has fined Grace Community Church every Sunday. Get this, Vince. Every Sunday since last August 2020. Threatening to arrest and criminally charge John MacArthur for meeting and such a defiance to what God says. Then tried to shut the church down. Since that didn't shut it down, MacArthur was ready to go to jail. Then tried to shut the church down by getting rid of their parking lot that they had for 30 or 40 years. And that didn't work. Then tried to shut the church down on health violations that they weren't violating, but they were twisting it to try to get them on that area. Then they fined them $1,000. Get this, Vince. I want your reaction to this. I want to see your face, Vince. Put Vince back on there. Listen to this, Vince. They fined them $1,000 because their health signs were in the wrong place. They had health signs on every door going in and out of the church, but they were in the wrong place. I don't know what the right place is. They fined them $1,000 for that, but that didn't stop them, though it was, as I said, at every door in the church. And then they started fining the church every Sunday since last August. Were you aware of this, Vince? Did you know this was going on? Every Sunday they meet?
Yeah, they asked John this past year, what are you going to do when they throw you in jail? And John made the great response, well, I'll start a jailhouse ministry.
So, praise the Lord.
Bad place for John to end up at. We can, he can evangelize the folks. Yeah. And I'm glad that he's not in there and they, he's out there outside. And he is a stalwart of the faith. I'm looking forward to what information that you have, though, in regards to McCotter, Jim.
Well, I just one other thing John McCotter said, and I quote, he said, ABC has tried to discredit us. CNN tried to discredit us. The LA Times has tried numerous times to discredit us. Ungodly bloggers tried to discredit us. They've said terrible things about us, lies, misrepresentations, inaccuracies. And they've all really, if they were honest, had to reject everything. When I was reading that, I said, well, I kind of know how he feels. I've had so many people lie about me and say all sorts of things that don't even exist. And you wonder, oh, I didn't know that. And
Jim, I didn't believe a word of it.
I beg your pardon?
I said, I didn't believe a word about it.
Well, because you know me, I guess. But they're saying all sorts of things about John McCotter. And all those who live godly in Christ Jesus, they will suffer persecution. But I just want to, I want to thank the Lord for men that will stand up and not yield to tyrannical government. And we never thought we'd have to do this in our country, as I'm sure you didn't and I didn't and most didn't. But we've kind of abdicated our responsibility in the civil government. And so wicked men, people that say they're Christians, Adolf Hitler, he said he was a Christian. People thought, the Lutheran church, some people thought he was a Christian. He was going to help them. He was going to help the church. He gave all sorts of platitudes like that, just like Biden did to the evangelicals on abortion. But once he got in office, they've never heard from him since then. So it's the same type of thing. That's why Jesus said, you shall know them by their, not words, but by their fruit, by their actions, what they do and their policies. That's how you can know them. I mean, Biden can say, and you can think he's the most beautiful Christian in the world. He's so sweet. He's so nice. But his policies are murder and perverted. And so we know him by their fruits. I don't dislike Biden for any other reason than that. I'm sure John the Baptist didn't dislike King Herod. But when they set that example and when they set the law contrary to the law of God, then they're under Satan. And isn't it interesting that Jesus said in the Gospel of John, the Pharisees, who many Christians don't realize, the Pharisees were the civil rulers. They were the political party. The Sadducees were the other part, side of the political party. The Sadducees were more like the Republicans, in some ways not, but because they were, but they said they were strict constitutionalists, Mosaic law, where the Pharisees would add to the law. And so when Jesus talked to the Pharisees, the civil leaders in the Gospel of John, he said, your father is the devil. Your father is the devil. So everybody really, their father is either the devil or it's God the Father. Those are the only two. And it says in Ephesians that when we get saved, he pulls us out of the kingdom of darkness, which is ruled by Satan, puts us into the kingdom of light, which is ruled by the Lord Jesus Christ. Anyhow, Vince, you can hang in here if you'd like. I wouldn't mind it. But I want to go over some things that John McCotter said a couple Sundays ago, January 17. Like I said, there's a lot of things I love about John, and I hate to say anything that might be negative, but it doesn't reflect on him. I think the world of him. I thank God for him, and God has used him so much. But I think there's been some, I think some things he said have been misleading, maybe not intentionally so, or some things that he may just feel different that I think need to be addressed. I'm going to quote and read some of what he said here. And oh, by the way, I read the other day that one of the evangelical publicists whether that is said he's happy to let us know that the new administration will uphold religious freedom. Really? Now, this is John MacArthur speaking here. The new administration will uphold religious freedom? I don't even support religious freedom. Religious freedom is what sends people to hell. To say I support religious freedom is to say I support idolatry. It's to say I support lies. I support hell. I support the kingdom of darkness. You can't say that. No Christian with half a brain would say we support religious freedom. We support the truth. They are of the devil's lies. The less they're going to tolerate the truth of Scripture. We condemn every lie and we call every person to this. There is one true God, quote, love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. And you'll have no other gods before me, end quote, right? There's salvation in one name and one name only. That's Jesus Christ. We will proclaim the exclusivity of the gospel, the unique revelation authority of Scripture. We're not going to lobby for freedom of religion. What kind of nonsense is that? Well, Vince, I'm glad you're here with me on hearing what I just read. And I don't know what you pick up on that. Most Christians, of course, believe in freedom of religion. Even though when that was used in the founding of our nation, it was always in reference to Christianity. It was never in reference to Buddhism, Muslim religion, Confucian, or any other religion. It was only Christianity, only Christians. That was the only way the word religion was ever used. All the others were considered irreligion or a cult or some philosophy, but not Christianity. So, and really, the colonies, there was not freedom for other religions at all. And even after the Constitution was signed in our country, the states had their constitutions, and they didn't allow for freedom for other false religions. Slowly, they began to change. But I think if MacArthur means religious freedom for all religions, I think he'd be right. I agree with that because of the first commandment. It says, I am the Lord your God who brought you out of slavery, and you'll have no other gods before me. So God's law, which Jesus quoted himself, that says to love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength, which is from the Old Testament Mosaic law. Therefore, that doesn't leave liberty for any so-called freedom of religions that would be untrue. Or as MacArthur said, that would be lies and would send people to hell and a destructive life here on earth individually and really destroy civilization. Communism is a religion. anything that you're devoted to, any philosophy, is your religion. Well, the Apostle Paul also said, what share can light have with darkness, or can Baal have with Christ? Satan, with his other religions, won't share with Christianity, not with God. Why are we so ignorant to think God will share with other false religions? Isaiah the prophet said, quote, referring that God said, and I quote, I will not share my glory with another, nor my praises with the graven images. So some things that MacArthur said, I think, were a little off, which I'm going to get to, at least in my understanding of Scripture. But I thought this was pretty revolutionary, what he said, not believing in freedom of religion. Have you heard that before, my brother?
On your show to clarify, I think you'll have to get MacArthur on your show to clarify his thought process on that. I would have to part ways on MacArthur. I love my freedom of religion. So I think it'd be best for him to clarify what exactly he's saying there.
Well, I think he's saying what I virtually quoted what he said. Now, mind you, most Christians, when you say, and Vince, feel free to say whatever you feel here. Most Christians want freedom of religion. When they say that, they're meaning freedom for everybody to purport and speak, you know, like all other false religions.
Right. For myself, it's in the context of the Judeo-Christian faith.
Yeah. Well, if you mean that, that's where I line up. But when I was younger in the Lord, I never thought much about it. And I thought to protect Christianity, we've got to have freedom for all religions. I remember being on the college campus many, many years ago when they started to close it up and not let us speak. And I would have hundreds and sometimes thousands of students that would come and want to listen and sit down on the lawn and be waiting to share. And finally, the universities and places would say, look, we can't let you speak out here anymore. And I'd say, you know, the answer is why? Because if we let you, we've got to let the other religions. And I thought, and most Christians don't know what to say and say, yeah, that makes sense. Why should I have liberty that they don't have? Well, here's why this is why you, this is why Christians should have liberty that people that don't embrace Christianity but embrace other religions should not have. Because God, if you're going to accept his word, both Old Testament as well as New Testament, he doesn't share. There's no verse in the scripture. In fact, he condemns lying. And unless you're sharing a truth about the Lord Jesus Christ, you're sharing lies. You're promoting what is treasonous to the King of Kings. And so I appreciate believers that think by saying we want to have freedom of religion so everybody can share. And they say truth will always win out. But the problem is truth does not win out unless you obey it. And the Bible makes clear that you have to separate from lies or it will affect you. Paul made that very clear in 1 Corinthians 5. He said, don't you know that a little leaven will leaven the whole lump? So you've got to take the leaven out or it'll affect the whole body, whether it's a whole church or whether it's a whole nation. And when other religions get control, I guarantee you, they will not allow Christians to speak because Satan knows that you can't allow freedom of religions. The Muslim countries don't, the communist countries don't, and gradually those that have come in the Judeo-Christian country, they've been pushing freedom of religion until Christians are finally getting further and further out. And now in schools, there are schools that are promoting the Muslim faith, but won't allow the Bible to be read. So it's now slowly turning, and it'll eventually be not only not allow it, not only will somebody like John MacArthur maybe be threatened to be a criminal and thrown in jail, but they'll take the next step eventually if we don't stand up and throw the leaders in jail one by one. Anyhow, let me keep going here because I got a few other things to get your thoughts. I title this one, We Lose. And this is where I'd like to sort it out a little bit. MacArthur went on to say in his sermon, oh, guess what? We don't win down here. We lose. You're ready for that, he said. Oh, you were a post-millennialist. You thought we were just going to be waltzing into the kingdom if you took over the world. No, we lose here. Get it? It killed Jesus. It killed all the apostles. We're all going to be persecuted. If any man comes after me, let him, what? Deny himself. Garbage of prosperity gospel. No, we don't win down here. You ready for that? Just to clear the air. I love this clarity. We don't win. We lose on the battlefield, but we win on the big one, the eternal one. But John 15, just read a couple of verses here. Our Lord talks to the disciples, chapter 15, verse 19. Verse 19, well, verse 18, let's start there. If the world hates you, you will know that it has. You know that it has. What? We don't win here. You get this? They killed him. They killed the apostles. And in every generation, they kill the people who proclaim the truth. Quote, you know that it hated me before it hated you. If you were of the world, verse 19, the world would love it its own. But because you're not of the world, so if you want the world to love you, you've got to convince them that you're not against them. But we are against them, not out of animosity, but out of love. If you were of the world would love its own, but because you're not of the world, but I choose you out of the world because of this, the world hates you. Chapter 16, verse 33, all the way at the end of that chapter, our Lord says, the end of the verse, in the world, you'll have trouble. Take courage. What? I've overcome the world. We don't win the battle here. You can't fight. Jesus said, my kingdom is not of this world, John 18. If my kingdom were of this world, my servants would, what? Fight. We're not fighting this world. We get it. Blessed are those who are persecuted. No, we don't win here. In fact, it gets worse, doesn't it? evil men get worse and worse. I mean, read the prophetic declarations of our Lord in the sermon of his second coming. Read the book of Revelation. It's not going to get better. It's going to get continually worse. And every generation of Christians is going to suffer for two reasons, because the world hates it and because the suffering perfects our faith and gives validity to our testimony. So we're not going to win. Well, just to say, a lot of things he said, I think, are really good here. But I think there's some confusion in what he said. One of the things he said, let's see. No, we can't win down here. Let me just read this if I can find it. I didn't mark it. But he said, no, we're all going to die in this generation. It isn't quite what he said. Let me see if I can just find this, because I think this spells, should have written it out here. I love you. The world loves the world because of this. King of darkness. Well, sure glad this is live, aren't you? The creation of the Lord, the sermon on the mount is coming. Well, anyhow, let me just say this to try to explain. I think everybody who does live godly in Christ Jesus will suffer persecution. There's various degrees of persecution, of course, as we know. Not everybody has been killed. Not everybody has been put to death. But I agree with the prophecy. Eventually, it's going to get bad, and there's going to be what's called the Great Tribulation. For the Bible makes clear there's going to be a Great Tribulation for 7 years, and that's going to be with the Antichrist, and that's going to be a very destructive time right before Jesus' second coming. I believe in the rapture, that we're going to be brought up to meet Jesus in the air. Some people believe it's before the tribulation. Some people believe it's in the middle of the tribulation. Some people believe it's at the end of the tribulation. I personally believe it's at the beginning, but I have perfect love and work with people that are mid-tribs or post-trib or, you know, whatever trib they are. Because guess what? No matter what you think or I think or anybody thinks, whenever Jesus is going to come, he's going to come. And my theology ain't going to make any difference about when he's going to come. So I think it's nice to try to know that and to learn that for a number of reasons. But it certainly should never have a bearing on us uniting with believers if some feel different. And Vince, I don't even know how you feel about, you know, when you think he's going to return. But for sure, the Bible says that we will be caught up together with him in the air, that's going to happen. That's what rapture means, caught up with him in the air, 1 Thessalians 4. And for sure, Jesus is going to come back to the earth. Those are two different events, because the one says we're going to meet him up in the air. The other one says he's going to come back to the earth. And most of the scriptures are prophesying, both the Old Testament and in Jesus, and many times of even what Paul says, is referring to his actual second coming, not the rapture, meeting him in the air, but the second coming, when he comes to the earth. And of course, then the millennium will be set up, and it's going to be beautiful. Until that time, since the time of Christ, there's been ebbing and flowing of various types of persecution. Of course, the Great Tribulation is going to be horrendous at that point. The Antichrist is going to have such control over the world. But here's the thing I want to say that kind of gives a thought, like, we can't win, we shouldn't try to win, kind of given up. I think Jesus said this, though. Jesus said, occupy until I come. And Jesus said for us to pray that his will be done here on earth right now. We know it means now, not in the future, because the next sentence he said, and also pray today that the Lord will give you your daily bread today here on earth. That's bread to eat here on earth each day. So he said, pray that his will be done here on earth right now. Well, I think God answers prayer. I don't think he's just holding a carrot out there to pray things will be, his will be done here on earth, but we know it's not going to be. So, in fact, I don't know that people think about praying for that. Furthermore, he said right now to seek first his kingdom, and that would be his will here on earth and his righteousness. And again, we know that's for here and now, because the very next verse even says, don't take any thought about tomorrow, sufficient unto the day is the evil of. And though we don't fight, we don't raise up guns and go out and shoot people, but we are to fight. Paul told Timothy more than once. He said, fight the good fight. and we're to fight with the weapons of our warfare. They're not carnal, but they're mighty, pulling down strongholds and casting down imaginations and everything against the knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ. And so I think there's a mix here. And of course you can throw out, oh, we're to suffer. Oh, God refines us through suffering. Those things are true, but there's also a whole body of scripture where God wants us to pray and work for peace and prosperity. Here he told Jeremiah the same thing when the believers went into exile. He said, pray for the city you're in Jeremiah 29. Pray for it and work for its prosperity and for its peace. And Paul, again, in the New Testament, he said the same thing. And the first priority that Paul gave in the church, 1 Timothy chapter 2, and he starts out the chapter, he uses the word first. That means it's priority number one. And he talks about praying for everyone, but especially kings and all those that are in authority. And it's very clear what he's telling them to pray for, especially that they won't be persecuted, just the opposite, but that they'll have tranquility, they'll have peace, and that they will be viewed with dignity. Can you believe that? And so that's what God wants. And I, even though Brother MacArthur has been under heavy persecution, not his life threatened, even though that's happened, you can easily kind of think, you know, this is it. This is the standard. Well, we don't need to assume that.
Yeah.
Even though we may in some ways die daily, even though we may literally be physically put to death, we don't need to assume that's our destiny. Let me mention a little bit more events, then you can pop in here. For example, it was prophesied that Nineveh would be destroyed. Nineveh, it was a godless, immoral, perverted, wicked city. It was the capital city. It was of the world. It would have been like Moscow under the Soviet Union or Beijing under communist China, or the capitals of the most wicked countries in the world, or like North Korea. And God told Jonah, the story that everybody knows, I want you to go up and preach to them to repent. Very interesting. Well, they weren't Jews. They were Gentiles. They didn't have anything to do with God. They weren't even in the same nation. But this was during the time of Israel. This is one of many reasons why we know God's law and God himself was to be honored in other nations, not just Israel. Jonah, he didn't want to go up to Nineveh. My goodness, he didn't like those people. They were dirty God haters and everything he abhorred. And he refused to go. I'm not going to go up there. He maybe thought God might bless him or something, or maybe he thought he'd die. I don't know what he thought exactly, but he went the opposite direction. You know the story. He got in the ship, sailed away, and God was about to destroy the ship. And all the sailors, they found out that Jonah was running from God, and that even Jonah himself said, unless you throw me overboard, we'll all die. They took Jonah, flipped him overboard, and God brought a fish, a great fish, and swallowed him for 3 days, which was the picture of Jesus dying and raising from the dead that Jesus referred to more than once. But the fish came and literally spit him out on the land, and certainly that was a miracle that God kept him alive. So there he was, spit out on the shore, and now he finally got the message, I better obey what God wants. You know, he didn't need to go through that miserable, it says he was caught in seaweed. It had to be the most horrifying experience. But yes, in a sense, God allowed him to be persecuted, and God trained him through it, but he didn't have to go through that if he'd have gone up there and preached like God told him to do the first time. Anyhow, going through the whale or big fish program, he was ready to go. And as you know the story, he went to Nineveh. And when he went to Nineveh, he preached the message of God, and this wicked capital power over the whole world, they repented. They repented in dust and ashes. The king repented, the people repented, and they turned to God, and God blessed this Gentile, this previously wicked nation. And yet it was prophesied that they would be destroyed because of their wickedness. But there was a period of time in that history when Jonah, contrary to what he believed, but he went and obeyed God. God gave a whole period of time in history and blessed Nineveh. And later, however, Nineveh, according to the prophecy, was finally fulfilled, and Nineveh was finally destroyed. So even though we have scripture that talks about the end and the great tribulation coming and things waxing worse and worse, and where there will be Christians for 7 years will be in serious people of God, if you believe in pre-tribulation rapture, the people of God at that juncture will be lifted off the earth, but there will be new people that will believe in God and the Lord Jesus at that time. But regardless, there will be people of God here on earth, and they will be heavy persecution, and then the Lord will come at the end. So I guess just as an example with Jonah, you don't have to assume because Jonah, because Nineveh was prophesied to be destroyed that, oh, we shouldn't go preach to it. We shouldn't expect Nineveh to ever repent or be godless because we know it's supposed to be destroyed because of its wickedness. So I'd just like to go back where, and I didn't find the phrase where Brother John talked about that we'll always be persecuted, we'll always suffer or be put to death. But that's not with all due respect, that's not true. There's lots of countries, United States being one example. The pilgrims came here in 1620 and they were blessed from then until recent this last generation. Christians were blessed. Christians were honored. God was honored. The majority of people were really in the colonial days, the vast 98% of all the people, actually 99% of all the people went to church every Sunday. I mean, it was a Christian nation and there was tremendous blessing. But as we've turned away from God here in recent generations, now we're beginning to suffer the persecution. Vince, I want to give you another little history lesson that relates to what I've just been shared, unless you want to get the word in.
Well, no, I would have to differ with John on that. I plan to do a lot of winning in 2021, Jim. And through the prophet Jeremiah, God says that, you know, the Lord is with me like a mighty warrior. What will I fear? That what can mortal man do with me? And I think you've hit on this recently, Jim, is that as Christians, we have to be on the offensive. I think we need to shift our mindset, is that we need to be on the offensive go. And you've hit on that rather than being on the defensive with our heels going backwards. The Christian folks, we need to be going forward, advancing his kingdom. And I think we know that the pilgrims, that was their mindset when they came to the shores, was to advance the kingdom of God.
And they said to set up, quote, a new Israel. And it's interesting, Vince, there's prophecy that says the church at the very end is going to turn prostrate. The religious leaders are going to be the beast. They're going to be godless. That'll be from the church, these false prophets. Even though we know that at the end, that doesn't mean that our church, and today it has to be that way, though some are that way, but it doesn't mean we need to just assume that since that's going to be the end, it's going to happen with every church today. Let me give you a little quick history, which you know and some people know. From 54 AD to with Nero, that's when he came into power, when the Apostle Paul was preaching, to Diocletian in 305 AD, there was a persecution off and on. But the majority of cities, Christians were not persecuted then, and not in every generation in those almost 250 years, even during that time. But Diocletian in 305, he was one of the worst. Nero was bad at the very beginning. He was horrible. He burned Christians in his garden, they said, lit him on fire. It was unbelievable. Diocletian was just as bad. They confiscated all the property of the Christians. They killed Christians. It was horrible. And so at that time, Christians thought, we're to be persecuted. It's going to be bad. It can never be good. We just get the gospel out. That's all we can expect. But nonetheless, God ordained the state. God does not want a bad state any more than he wants a bad church, who he has ordained, any more than he wants a bad family. So we may not be able to change families. We may not be able to change the state. We may not be able to change the church. But we know what God wants, and we pursue it. And when it was the darkest at times with Diocletian, one of the worst persecutors of the people of God, what happened? 305, God raised up Constantine the Great, who delivered the believers, who put in the law of God as the civil law, and gave freedom for believers, and had the bishops and the spiritual leaders be the advisors and the judges in the land. So it was so dark, it got worse, and they thought it's gotten worse and worse, and that's the way it's going to be because we're just going to be persecuted. It turned it around. And during the entire reign of Constantine the Great, there was not only no persecution, Christians were blessed. They gave them back their land. They gave them back their money. They gave them, they put God's law in place. Well, that happened in the early fourth century. But then you go through and things did ebb and flow and got bad. But then you get to Pope Leo the X, who was a ruthless, godless pope. Some popes were not so bad as others, but Pope Leo the X was definitely not good. They were, you know, selling ways to get to heaven. You give us money and you can get to heaven. Godless, perverted things and corrupt in so many ways. And it looks so dark for the Christians. But then what happened? Things were waxing worse and worse. And then God raised up Martin Luther, and then John Calvin, and then John Knox, and then Zwingli. And all of a sudden, these Catholic, Roman Catholic states that were dominated by oppression and persecution, if you ever said anything, the whole Western world turned upside down and became Christianized. And they were blessed, and there was prosperity. Not perfect, but no nation that you, even if you say it's Christianized, will ever be perfect any more than any Christian is perfect. But they went towards the ways of God versus the ways of Satan. So when it got the darkest, that's when God raised up his men. And it was the believers that changed things, just like Constantine, who professed the Lord Jesus Christ. And he changed things. And the bishops and the other Christians, leaders, they changed things. Millions came to know Christ through Martin Luther and Calvin and Zwingli and Knox and all these reformers. And the Western culture, Christian culture in Europe was raised up, which was a blessing for Christians, really, for hundreds of years. But then it's interesting to think about, and just to give you a little more on this, in the beginning of the 17th century, many Christians had to flee England under King James I of England because of the persecution. They'd put them in jail or kill them. The pilgrims who fled England to Holland and then finally left Holland came to the Mayflower to go where? To the free world, to the new world, and they started a, quote, the new Israel. So where there was persecution, God allowed them to be freed, and they established one of the freest, one of the most Christian, one of the most prosperous nations ever in the world. And basically, it was because of Christianity. But prior to that, there was many Christians that thought this is the end with King James and many others in Europe. Even though they had Reformation, then there was a reaction to those Reformations. Then in the 18th century, under the oppression of King George III, this guy was insane. And at the same time, as a result of George Whitefield preaching through all the colonies of America, where the Americans were being oppressed in many ways, the British soldiers were moving into the houses and taking over the different houses, tremendous persecution. George Whitefield affected the masses of Christians, and literally most every American after George Whitefield preached for years in every colony from the north to the south. So many were born again that virtually every American went to church every Sunday. The Christian Americans, the American Christians, rose up to have what was really called the American War of Independence. And George III said it's the black robe that caused it. In other words, he was accusing the Presbyterians because of their theology, believing in freedom and that Jesus should be our king and not a human king. Anyhow, this Great Depression, what happened? It popped out and there was great liberty as a result. It resulted in the most Christian and most free country in the world. And then during the days of the 1940s, many thought, and that wasn't too long ago, that Adolf Hitler was the Antichrist, and that the persecution, he was taking over all of Europe, and it was, things were waxing worse and worse, and that was going to be the end. But God delivered the world of Hitler, and we experienced great Christian freedom for generations after that, up till really now, more recent time again, where we're being oppressed again. So eventually the Antichrist will come. Eventually this will all happen. But this does not mean, in my opinion, that we should not. The bottom line is this, in my opinion, Vince. Did God ordain the state? That's the question a Christian needs to ask. And if you think not, then Romans 13, you ought to tear it out of your Bible. And 1 Peter chapter 4, you ought to tear it out of your Bible. And Titus, where it talks about the state, not to speak of the Old Testament, where it started, he ordained the state. And if God ordained the state, he wants it to be holy. God doesn't ordain something. He wants Satan to rule. And even like the church or even like a family. So those are my few thoughts on that. Do you have anything you want to add before I jump to another subject with John MacArthur?
Well, only because you mentioned John Knox, I love his quote, talk with God are the majority, and we need reformers today in our churches and our country. And that's why I'm so excited about this program, Christian Now, Christian Nation Now, and throughout the week. Jim, good job.
Let me just share the next thought: social justice. John MacArthur said this, and I think this is good. So much compromise, horrible compromise, much of it because of the social justice issue. That is a disaster, maybe more than any single disaster, but collectively with everything else has done in irreparable damage. Said it would, and it has, and is not nearly done. But the whole evangelical, seemingly elite, rolled over and brought into social justice, critical race theory, intersectionality, racial identity. And now we're going to have the fruit of it. I'll give you an illustration. Americans always functioned with equal justice. Get that? Equal justice. I mean, the modifier is clear, right? Equal. Equal for everybody. Everybody's equal under the law. That's equal justice. No, it's gone. Now we have social justice. What social justice means is unequal justice. It means that it is justice to basically determine by whether you're a part of the oppressed group or the oppressors. What you're seeing in America when the new president says, quote, in the future, all the money from the government is going to go to homosexuals, LGBTQ, et cetera, et cetera, end quote. That is social justice. That's not equal justice. When you hear the new attorney general say, end quote, in the future, all charities are going to have to give their money to disenfranchised, oppressed minorities like homosexuals, end quote. You're realizing, MacArthur says, that you have just seen the death of equal justice. How could a Christian jump on that bandwagon? Something pretty clear. God does not hold somebody else responsible for what's wrong with you. He holds you responsible. Social justice blames someone else for your defects and sin. How could Christians get anywhere near that? I did a series on Ezekiel 18 trying to make that clear. We saw last week, I think it was, where in Deuteronomy, where it was first given that the father's sin will not be, the son will not be punished for the father's sin, and the son's sins will not be punished for the father's sin, Ezekiel 18 says. And social justice is just turn that up on its end. And I think John MacArthur is just right on in this area. It's not social justice is just another term to distort true justice, equal justice, and certainly God's justice. Any other thought?
Well, yeah, that's what got me stumped is how does a Christian jump on that bandwagon, Jim? And, you know, sad to say, but we
have
only because you brought up the Vatican, the Catholic Church, we have yet to hear from the Vatican on rebuking one of their own. And we heard a lot from him when he rebuked President Trump, but we have yet to hear him say anything in correcting one of his own. It totally astonishes.
Well, he's a socialist himself, and that's why. John MacArthur's message in January 24, which was the next one on this subject, and I want to quote what he said here. We hail democracy. In our country, we have spent countless dollars, countless lives, countless years trying to turn other countries into democracies like us. Now, it may shock you, the Bible doesn't advocate democracy. So, you know, he's right on that. That can be confusing. And certainly, I like what Ann Coulter said when we went over to Afghanistan and they were trying to have democracy. But she said, what we need to do is convert them to Christ and have Bibles in there. Did you know after this, in the Second World War, when we had prisoners, the chaplains went in and would try to lead them to Christ and would give them Bibles. When we had the war in Afghanistan and Iran, what we did was give them Qurans and put their prayers, so-called, over the loudspeaker. We've turned from that generation, from the Second World War, now to actually program it. I remember seeing a general in Afghanistan, how they were being given such praise because they built a mosque for the Muslims. So in essence, we went in and just got rid of one godless group for promoting another godless group. And democracy certainly doesn't work if you don't have moral people, as John Adams said. But the founding fathers, they really thought a pure democracy. They called it, quote, mobocracy. And because that just means the majority rules, and that isn't biblical. And it wasn't even true with our Constitution. Our Constitution was more of a republic, which is closer, not the same, but closer to what the what God's civil government is. But there's, if you want to call this democracy, it's really not a true democracy at all. But people did find and choose representatives. Even in the church, remember the apostles, when they needed food administration, they told the people of God to choose seven men for that administration. So they chose those men to do that work. And then in Deuteronomy in the Old Testament for the civil judges, God through Moses said, you choose the judges that would represent God in making judgments over the people. So the people did make choices, but it wasn't just a, but they didn't make choices as far as the law. That's the big distinction with this. The law, this was the law. God's law was given by revelation. That was the law. Then they had judges that would judge people to see if they were following God's law. And if the judges were good, God blessed the nation. If the judges weren't good, they weren't blessed. Vince, we've gone over time. Do you have anything you want to say before we cut off?
The psalmist David, blessed is a nation whom God, whom the Lord is God. So right now, America's in turmoil, Jim, and we need reformers more so than ever right now, spiritual reformers.
Yeah. Blessed is the nation that it says in Proverbs that is righteous. And that it's interesting. That wasn't just for Israel. It was any nation. So, Vince, the Lord bless you, brother. Hopefully this has helped some. And see you tomorrow at 4 p.m., everybody. And we'll be looking at New Testament Church, which is the pillar and support of the truth. The church is gets strong. There's nothing that can't happen. We can reach a city, and we can reach a nation, and actually have Christian nations. And we should have Christian nations. We should have Christian cities. But the church has got to do its job in getting the gospel out to everybody and then teaching the whole counsel of God. Love you, Vince. Love you guys that are watching. See you tomorrow at 4 p.m. Eastern Time. Finished our broadcast today. Above all wealth and treasures of the earth, there's no way to measure what you're worth. Crucified, laid behind a stone, you lived to die. Rejected it.